this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to Wednesday with God on this wonderful Wednesday evening, or whatever day that you're watching this broadcast of this video. We praise God, this presentation. We thank God for you being with us on today. Call a neighbor, call a friend, tell them that Unity Baytown is on the air everywhere. Get your Bibles, something to write with and something to write on. Prepare yourself to take some good notes as we prepare to study the Word of God together. As always, we thank you for tuning in, those of you who tuned in with us this afternoon at 12 noon for the Sweet Hour Prayer, which is every Wednesday at 12 noon. We pray that you will come in as we go before the throne of God, as the people of God, to talk to our God on behalf of our concerns and the concerns of others. So we invite you every Wednesday at 12 noon to come with us to the presence of God at the Sweet Hour of Prayer. All right? Well, get your Bibles. Turn with me, if you have your Bibles, to the Old Testament book of Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter number 29. Deuteronomy chapter 30. I began last time we were here, I began a series, a teaching entitled Generational Cycles. And today, that's what we want to deal with today. I want to continue on the teaching of generational cycles. So prepare yourself, call a neighbor, call a friend. As a matter of fact, do us the honor of liking, tagging, and sharing this Bible study with somebody. You may know somebody or their family who may need to understand what it means to go through generational cycles. And so I pray that you will be blessed by what you're about to receive now. Let's go to the Word. Let's go to God in prayer before we go to the Word. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for this opportunity to call on your name. We thank you for keeping us all day long, all week long, bringing us to this very present moment. So many people wish they could be where we are. And so, God, now that we're here, help us to not take for granted the blessings and the amenities and the things that you've blessed us to receive. For all things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. And so, God, as your word go forth, let your people be receptive and responsive to your word, so that when this time of sharing is over, we can apply this word for the living out of our days. And it is so, and it cannot be otherwise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, Deuteronomy chapter number 30. This will serve as our foundation scripture for our lesson on today. It says, Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 19 and 20, it says, this day, and we're reading from the New International Version, this day I called heaven and earth as witnesses against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Now, choose life, so that you and your children may live, and that you may love the Lord your God, listen to his voice, and hold fast to him. For the Lord is your life, and he will give you many years in the land he swore to give your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So reads the word. Amen. We're talking today about generational cycles. Let those of you, if this is your first time with us, let me just kind of catch you up on what we have been going through. We initiated this conversation or this study on what it means to have generational cycles. And for those of you who were not with us last week, let me just give you a definition of what it means to have a generational cycle. A generational cycle is a thought, perspective, and or belief that is emotionally or culturally passed down from our families. I'll say that to you again. A generational cycle is a thought, perspective, and or belief that is emotionally or culturally passed down from our families. One more time. A generational cycle is a thought, perspective, and or belief that is emotionally or culturally passed down from our families. What it is it's the lens through which we see the world that is shaped by our parents' grandparents, and key influencers, and can also be influenced by culture, ethnicity, and events. We pass along this generational cycle through words, actions, and attitudes. That's what the definition of a generational cycle was. Then last week, we told you that it is believed that a generational cycle is passed down from one generation to another due to rebellion against God, because some cycles were passed down through blessings, but then some were passed down through disobedience. And we talked about that in our lesson. We began to talk about that, how this particular event of cycle sharing goes from one generation in our family to the next generation in our family. And many of us today can acknowledge it, or we don't want to acknowledge it, but there are some things that our family does that no one else in our other families do. It's something in our families that many of us hate to see, but it's prevalent and it's powerful. And because it's prevalent and powerful, because we as people have become passive with it. We've become passive. And so it is our responsibility, those of us who are mature in the Lord, those of us who are strong in the Lord, must develop the awareness that cycles in our families are existing, and they cannot be passed over or swept up under the rug, but they have to be confronted. One person said on one particular occasion, you'll never conquer what you don't confront. So with that being said, let's deal with what we talked last week, and I started with the origin of cycles and how it emanated from Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve were they were not the ones who brought sin into the world, but they introduced sin to the world. How was that so? Because sin was in the serpent, and the serpent was being guiled or guided by Satan himself. Satan needed something to move throughout this world in the natural sense. And so he used the serpent to beguile Eve, and Eve took the fruit, gave it to Adam, they ate, and now sin has now a presence in the world. David said on one occasion in our last lesson that he was born in sin, at Psalm 51, and shaped in iniquity. So the origin of cycles starts with the committal of sin, and then it continues with the continuity of sin, that once it has been introduced, then now it has latched on to our human and spiritual DNA. Consequently, every person that is born in this world is born with sin in their DNA. And whatever your sin is, causes a fueling of the cycles in your family. You and I cannot honestly say that there is no sin in our families, especially that some of our families have noted but ignored. For many of us in our families, when you go to the doctor, and you fill out the information in the doctor's office. Now, as you go to the doctor's office, they ask you, okay, what do you have? What is it that you're dealing with? And if you're dealing with something, they ask you, well, is there anyone else in your family that dealt with it? Has there anyone else in your family that died? And if they died, what did they die from? And many of us, especially in the African American community, we list certain sicknesses like heart disease, high blood pressure, cancer, diabetes, eye problems, leg problems, things of that nature. The way we eat are generational cycles. And yes, our food has a heritage, but there's a harmful cycle that goes along with the heritage that we have. Because we eat and eat, and nobody ever talks about gluttony being a sin. You know, we have feasts and fellowships, and many people, if you like some of the people in my family, we like to eat. Some of the people in our church family, we like to eat. And because we eat, we don't eat and take care of ourselves. And what we do is we perpetuate this cycle where we have obese saints. Oh, we're fit in certain areas, but when it comes to our health, we preach holiness, but not healthiness. I don't know if that's a word or not, but I used it. Okay, so with that being said, we're picked up now, we're caught up now with what where we stopped on last week. And so today we want to continue with this generational cycles, as we talked about the origin of the cycles. But number two, I want to deal with the occurrence of cycles. How often do these cycles occur? Well, number one, they occur in the family. Number one, they start in the family. The occurrence of cycles occur in our family. Why am I saying the family? Because the family was the first institution that God originated. He did not originate the church first. He did not start the church or a convention or a denomination or a social club or any other entity. Marriage, family, was the first thing that God instituted. And incidentally, it is also the first thing that the enemy attacked, because you cannot have a strong church without family. You cannot have a strong community without family. If you want to know what people are looking for today, when it comes to attention, they're looking for attention from family. Got it? Okay, so let's see how the cycle of sin originates in the family. Okay, if you have your Bibles, go with me to Genesis chapter number 4. Genesis chapter number 4. And again, as you're watching this, I encourage you to like, tag, and share this. If you know somebody who would be blessed by this, like, tag, and share this. Share this with somebody that you know may be blessed. Genesis chapter 4. Now remember, Adam and Eve had already been, introduced sin into the world. They had already committed sin. They were cast out of the Garden of Eden as a punishment for their sin. Now, although they were kicked out of Eden, they still continued on with their life, because when God said that they would surely die, it meant a separation from the perfect tent of the presence of the relationship between humanity and divinity. And many of us, because we are sin natured, there is a separation between us and God. But thanks be to God that through Jesus Christ, we are now brought back into fellowship with God. However, it is the sin that continues to separate us from the power and the presence of God. All right, Genesis chapter 4, let's start at verse number 6. Genesis chapter 4, verse number 6. Let me cue up the context of this particular scripture. Adam and Eve had a son named Cain, and then they had another son named Abel. One was a tiller of the ground who grew vegetables and fruits and all of that good stuff. One of them tended sheep. So one day, God told them to bring an offering. They brought an offering before the Lord, the first offering. And as they brought the first offering, Cain brought the mess. It wasn't the first, it wasn't the best. It was the residuals, the leftovers of his crop, his increase, his harvest. But Abel brought the first fruit, the first portion of his increase, the first lamb. And they both gave it to God, and God looked on Abel's with pleasure. Now, let's pick it up in verse number 6. Got it? Okay. Verse number 6. Okay. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must master it." Now Cain said to his brother Abel, "Let's go out into the field." And while they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Where's your brother Abel?" "I don't know," he replied. "Am I my brother's keeper?" Then the Lord said, "What have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Now you are under a curse and are driven from the ground, which opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand." Now I want you to see the context of this. Their father and mother had already sinned and were driven away. Now, because another sin has been committed, now they are driven further. One of them have been driven away even the more. Sin drives us away from the presence of God. Now, if sin drives us away, then I would suggest to you and I that if there is a sin cycle in our families, then sin drives a wedge between family members to the point where there is no unity, but there is disunity. There is division. And the scripture says that a house divided against itself cannot stand. So with that being said, when there is a cycle of sin in our families, we can tell because the family is not on one accord. When there is dissension amongst brother and sister, mother and daughter, father and son, it is primarily because there is a sin that has not been addressed and has not been handled. I know what you're saying. Well, man of God, there's no division in our family. Our family is on one accord. Is that the truth? Let's be honest. There's some dysfunction in every family. There's no such thing as a perfect family. If you say that your family is perfect, you're lying. That word, Bishop C.D. Mitchell says you're in denial. What does denial mean? Don't even know I am lying. Yeah, that's what denial means. Some people don't even understand that while they're trying to sweep it under the rug and make it look publicly that your family has it all together, it is a huge pile of dirt under that rug you've been sweeping up under. And pretty soon, it will become a heap of dirt and dust that has not been attended to, because in the eyesight of those who are in denial, there's nothing wrong. But you have to address the elephant in the room. You have to address that there is a division in your family. You have to address that there is something that somebody did to offend the other person. There's a grandmother who's had animosity with her sisters. There's an uncle who's had beef with his nephews or nieces. There's molestation that has happened in the family, and nobody wants to admit it. But the same uncle that did it to mama and did it to Amy is also doing it to baby girl, and nobody wants to admit it. You try to keep baby girl away from uncle, but the truth be told, nobody has ever addressed uncle, because uncle got money, uncle got prestige, uncle does this, uncle does that. Or if we told uncle's wife, she wouldn't be able to handle it, and it would cause derision and more duress in the family. But my brothers and sisters, we need to protect each other from the sins in our family before this sin destroys family. Let me say that again. We have to protect each other from the sin in our families before the sin destroys our families. Am I making sense? Okay, so Cain did not commit the same sin as his parents, but the pattern of sin became present in Cain as it did in Adam. So even though Daddy Adam sinned one way, son Cain sinned another way. And so after that, there's a sin pattern that keeps going. You must understand, sin is now introduced. And so if it's not one particular sin, then it is another sin. Let me tell you what my grandmother used to tell me. My grandmother said, if you lie, you'll steal. And if you'll steal, you'll kill. Three different sins. But if you do one, you'll have to do another. Let me tell you what else they used to teach us. If you tell one lie, you have to keep on telling that lie to back up the lie that you originally told. And soon thereafter, you keep just keep telling lies and lies and lies. And then you got to do something to back up the lie. And then it gets so crazy that some people actually begin to believe the lie they said. So now you're brainwashed by your own lie. My God. Okay, so when the cycles are initiated, then they can be imitated. Remember that. When cycles are initiated, then they can be imitated. Okay? Our families have the greatest influence on our development, including the development on our patterns of sin. Okay, I want you to see this. According to an article on destinyimage.com, the following story of two American families illustrates the power of generational cycles. Okay? Max Jukes was an atheist who married a godless woman. Some 560 descendants were traced. And watch this. 310 of them died as paupers or poor, down and out. 150 became criminals. 7 of them murderers. 100 of them were known to be alcoholics, and more than half of the women were prostitutes. The descendants of Max Jukes cost the United States government more than $1.25 million in the 19th century. Now, there's another guy named Jonathan Edwards. Jonathan Edwards was a contemporary of Max Jukes. He was a committed Christian who gave God first place in his life. He married a godly lady, and some 1,394 descendants were traced. Of that, 295 graduated from college, of whom 13 became college presidents, and 65 became professors. Excuse me. 3 were elected United States senators, 3 as state governors, and others were sent as ministers in foreign countries. 30 became judges, 100 became lawyers, 1 the dean of an outstanding law school, and 75 became officers in the military. 100 were well-known missionaries, preachers, and prominent authors. Another 80 held some form of public office, of whom 3 were mayors of large cities. 1 was the comptroller of the United States Treasury, and another was the vice president of the United States of America. Not one of the descendants of the Edwards family was a liability to the government. What are you trying to say? Now, some people would disagree that you know, sin would cause, you know, my family was successful and we're all sinners. God reigns on the just as well as the unjust. Yes, he does. However, what you must understand, you can get by sometimes with sin, but you don't get away from the punishment of sin. And check this out. You can choose your pleasure of sin, but you cannot choose your punishment of sin. Gotta remember that. You can choose your pleasure of sin, but you cannot choose your punishment of sin. Which means if you don't know what you're going to wind up with, you might want to play it safe. Especially when it comes to your family. Amen? So, we talked about the occurrence of sin in the family. But let's come a little closer to home, and I think I'll end this part on tonight. The second part is, there's a generational cycle in the family. And number two, there's a generational cycle of occurrence in the faith. Yes, in the faith. That means in the church. Yes, because again, you must understand, churches are comprised of families. Can you name one church that you've ever been a part of that didn't have a big family in it? Think about it. I'll give you a moment to think about it. You yourself, if you're watching me, you are probably a part of that prominent family in the church. Your big mama, your grandmama, your daddy, your uncles, all of them had prominence in the church. Somebody was a deacon, somebody was an usher, somebody was a mission sister, somebody was a choir president, somebody was one of the ministers, some of them, your predecessor or your family member was the pastor. And yet, what we don't understand is the same sin that is in our house, don't miss this, it comes with us to God's house. Sin does not stop because we come to church. As a matter of fact, we bring sin with us to church. We don't ever want to acknowledge that. But the same cussing you do at home, you cuss in church. You may not do it publicly, but it does. The same way you have lustful thoughts at home, you have lustful thoughts in the house of the Lord. The same way you have a messy demeanor at home, you have a messy demeanor right at church. Let me show you what I mean by this cycle. All right, if you have your Bibles, go to 1 Samuel chapter 2. 1 Samuel chapter 2. Sin creeps into church with us. Okay. Sin follows us to church. Yes, if it doesn't follow us to church, then we gotta stop saying just as I am without one plea. Let me give you this, and oh God, I'll be done. Okay. 1 Samuel chapter 2. Okay, 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 12. 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 12. Okay, Eli's sons were wicked men. They had no regard for the Lord. Now it was the practice of the priest that whenever anyone offered a sacrifice, and while the meat was being boiled, the servant of the priest would come with the servant with a three-pronged fork in his hand. He would plunge it into the pan or kettle or cauldron or pot, and the priest would take for himself whatever the fork brought up. This is how they treated all of the Israelites who came to Shiloh. But even before the fat was burned, the servant of the priest would come and say to the man who was sacrificing, "Give the priest some meat to roast. He won't accept boiled meat from you, but only raw." If the man said to him, "Let the fat be burned up first, and then take whatever you want," the servant would then answer, "No, hand it over now. If you don't, I'll take it by force." My God. The sin of the young men were very great in the Lord's sight. for they were treating the Lord's offering with contempt. So now you got a man by the name of Samuel, Eli, who has two sons who are being corrupt in the church. And I'll end that for right now. I want to offer Jesus Christ to somebody. My time is up. There might be somebody here today who would like to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You see, yes, I was talking about corruption in the house and corruption in the house of the Lord. But just because other people are corrupt don't mean you have to be corrupt. Don't miss church because somebody else decides they want to treat God's house with contempt. You can accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, because every tub got to stand on its own bottom. You cannot stand before God because of what other people did. You have to stand because of what you and God have done together. Would you like to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? It's as simple as praying a prayer. The Bible says whoever confesses with their mouth and believes within the heart the Lord Jesus, you shall be saved. Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sin, and he rose the third day with all power in his hand. If you believe that and that he is the Son of God, you shall be saved. Pray this prayer with me. Father, I come to you a sinner. I repent of my sin. Forgive me. Come into my life and save me. I believe in Jesus Christ. He is the Son of God. He died for my sin and rose from the dead. Father, fill me with your Holy Spirit. Lead me, guide me, and I will live for you the rest of my life. Thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer, God bless you. Welcome to the body of Christ. I'm excited for the decision you just made. Now you need to make another one, and that's find you a Bible-believing, Bible-teaching church where Jesus Christ is exalted and the Word of God is explained. I want to invite you to become a part of the best church in Baytown. It's the church where everybody is somebody. We're not a perfect church, but we'll be perfect to have you. There's some information right there on the screen as to how you can become a part of our church. If you've accepted Jesus Christ, then we invite you to become as a candidate for baptism. That means you've accepted Jesus Christ, but you have not followed his command and be baptized in water. We invite you to do so. Or if you have been baptized, but you need a church home, you can come by letter from another church or by Christian Experience. That means that you've been saved and now you're looking for a permanent church home. Then you could come by restoration, which means you walked away from the church, but you want to come back. Or thirdly, or finally, if you're in town for a season and you need a church to become a part of, we receive you by watch care. That means we'll cover you and watch over you until you leave and go back home. Whatever your mode of coming, we receive you. Use all the information on the screen to contact us, and we'll be happy to receive you. These people who are part of this church would love to be your brother and sister. I would love to be your pastor. Hallelujah. Listen, if you have not paid your tithes and offerings, you're more than welcome to do so. The information on the screen is how you can pay your tithes and offerings and be a blessing to the man of God. Do know that as you give, God promised he'd give it back to you good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men and women give into your bosom. Take advantage of these opportunities. You don't have to wait till Sunday morning to pay your tithes and offerings. You can do it right now, and God will bless you just the same. Well, I hope you were blessed by today's lesson. If this lesson was a blessing to you, please, ma'am, please, sir, do us the honor of liking, sharing, and tagging this word for somebody else. You never know who you might bless with this word of God. Well, we're going to pick this up with the Lord's will next time. I pray that you will have a blessed week in the Lord. I look forward to seeing you here Sunday morning for morning worship as we gather in the presence of the Lord. You can either join on site or online. You've got two ways to praise, but either way, we look forward to seeing you in church. Well, our time is up. We've got to go. I pray, as always, that the rest of your week would be the best of your week. We love you. We miss you. Can't wait to see you. And until next time, the blessings of the Lord be upon you. We bless you in the name of the Lord. Peace and favor.